We're giving praises to our mighty good God.
Yes, Father.
To my fellow yokemen in the ministry.
God bless you, Pastor.
To the leadership here at Pine Island and Echo Baptist Church. Every auxiliary. My brothers and sisters here in Christ and our first lady in the house.
Amen. Amen.
We bid you a good morning and God's blessing.
Amen.
Amen. I heard he might not come when you want him.
But
he's a, anybody know he's gonna write on time, God.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Frank, we didn't miss you, brother. I was wondering about you.
Amen.
I was gonna ask God to tell Gabriel where he at. Amen.
All right,
I see God is about to thus for you. You still a protected man, huh? Amen. Amen. We'd like to this morning bring you a word from the Lord. And we ask you to stand as we go into the book of Matthew. Book of Matthew, and starting at the 9th chapter. Matthew 9. When you have that, just say amen.
Amen.
Matthew 9th chapter, and we'll be starting at the 35th verse. And I'm reading out the NIV, New International Version. And it reads, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Let us leave with you a thing this morning, the nature of prayer. The nature of prayer. You may be seated. The nature of prayer. We find out in this particular scripture that of all the words spoken by our Savior, that I hope that we cherish and allow to dwell within us. Anybody got some nuggets from the words?
Okay, now.
Amen. And in our time of distress, we just like to call on them. Amen. They strengthen us. But according to these words that we cherish and allow to dwell within us, we should rejoice and celebrate this most gracious invitation contained in this text. And it simply says, and we've heard it before, that the harvest is plentiful. But the laborers, those that are willing to work, are few. And it suggests here the solution to the problem is that we should pray.
Yeah.
Therefore, that the Lord of the harvest, not any type of Lord, but the one that we say, our Father, who art in heaven.
Yeah.
That we pray to that Lord of the harvest, that he will do something, that he will send out laborers, that he will send out Holy Ghost filled people. To have a desire to fulfill his will, his commandment.
Yeah.
To have a love for his son, Jesus. Yeah. That he will send out laborers to have a compassion for Christ's people. That he will send out those laborers that they may go out into the harvest. Now, I come to tell you that this morning that many of us live with only a partial understanding of what was communicated in this scripture.
Yeah, all right.
And therefore, because we have a limited communication command has been either lukewarm rather than enthusiastic. We find out that most view this verse as an encouragement to pray. To pray for what, Pastor? Or to pray for Christian workers when there are vacancies in the church. To pray, congregations pray. They have lift their hearts up to God when they are without a pastor. Pastors have used this verse for praying that God will send workers for the music ministry. They're praying for teachers for Christian education. They're praying for individuals to work within the children's ministry.
All right, come on.
And I come to tell you, not too far, but certainly this type of request is encouraged by the text. But I come here this morning to help you to look a little deeper for the understanding.
A lot deeper,
To see this is the only meaning is to miss the best part of the verse. Many of us fail to understand of this passage. Why? Because of our inadequate concept about prayer. We think of prayer in terms of bringing a request to God and asking God for a certain thing. We want our stuff. And not only do we want our stuff, but sometimes we might even ask for things for other people. We might ask for God to change other folks' lives. But I come to tell you, when we pray like this, we view prayer as a one-way conversation where we approach the throne of God and present our needs. We fail to see that prayer is not a one-way conversation, but it's two-way. In which we come to God, and Father God also comes to meet us. We offer our request to God, but we should also give God the opportunity to offer his response to our prayers. Come on, somebody. How? By sending us a suggestion, by giving us commandments, by sending us directions. Some of us haven't realized the true nature of prayer. I come to tell you this morning that effective prayer is composed of certain characteristics. Prayer consists of talking. We are familiar with that. But prayer also consists of listening. And once we listen, prayer is also considered about agreeing.
All right.
Now, if we remove any part or change any part of this prayer process, we change the whole composition. You're not prayer. You're talking loud, but you ain't really saying nothing. It's something like, I'd rather be talking to Sister Collins about this. So some of you ladies that are familiar with the kitchen, there's a process in baking the cake. But I heard if you remove the flour and the milk, if you don't put no sugar in the cake, you might have something looking like a cake, but really it's a hot mess. Fellas, let me talk to you. You might not know what Pastor talking about. We talk about getting up in the kitchen, talk about no baking. You some of us look, some of the men look at a microwave as a godsend. But let me talk to you about something. If you are washing your car, or go to the car wash and you don't have no water.
Come on, Pastor. What's going to happen?
What I'm saying is you might move some dirt around. But on the long range, you ain't really did nothing. So I come and tell you that you don't come to pray no any kind of way. Part is my job as a spiritual leader and the pastor is not only to encourage you, Pine Line, to pray, but I also have to teach you how to pray. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
So when we look at prayer, first thing, prayer is listening to God. Those who will pray effectively. Now, I hope you come to pray effectively. Effectively means that you need to get your prayer from you and up to God. A lot of us are just going up and hitting the ceiling and this bouncing back down. walk and not faint.
Yes.
I come to tell you, we live in a time I ain't seen so many tired saints in my life.
Oh,
they're tired. They're weary. They're willing to give up. But the Bible said, and I got to understand that you might be doing it right, but the Bible said, wait on the Lord. Ain't no sense giving God a whole request list and you're not willing to wait on His answer.
That's right. That's right.
Trusting in God helps us. Trusting helps us to be prepared when God speaks to us. Then it says we trust and we wait. Then we'll be patient when He asks us to wait. And not only when He asks us to wait, but we'll believe that God is able to fulfill all His promises.
Yeah, yeah.
Somebody might ask, well, Pastor, you're saying wait on the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Well, let me explain to you, well, how does God speak to us? Sometimes it can be verbal.
Okay.
Sometimes God may use the scriptures to speak to us. Sometimes God speaks through lyrics in a song. Sometimes God will speak through a phrase within a sermon. Sometimes God may speak to us by laying on such a burden of concern that we feel compelled to do His will. I said sometimes God will lay on you a burden that you feel that you can't even get up. Just to catch your attention. Anybody remember in the book Numbers chapter 22 that God made Balaam's donkey talk?
Yes.
You remember it says in verse 23 that when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with his sword drawn out in his hand to kill Balaam, that the donkey tried to veer off the road. Balaam felt he was insulted and embarrassed by his old mule and started to beat that old mule down. And I heard that God touched the donkey. And the donkey looked at old Balaam and asked him, why are you beating me so? He said, now have I ever embarrassed you? And the Bible said that Balaam looked at him and started a conversation with the mule. And the Bible said that God opened up his eyes and Balaam saw the angel of the Lord standing there to strike him down. I come to tell you, you need to be quiet sometime and wait for God to speak. What is the nature of prayer? Prayer is hearing what God has to say. Many make the sad mistake of rushing into the presence of God with our so-called grocery list, with requests, and to speak to Him as if we were the boss of a corporation.
Yeah.
And that God was nothing but administrator help.
Yeah.
But I come to tell you, don't get it twisted. You need to reverse the concept and see that God is the CEO.
Yeah.
That God has the right to give us the guidelines to follow. God has the right to give us the suggestions.
Yeah.
And God has the right to give us the orders. And I come to tell you, as we read through the great prophetic books of the Old Testament, we will discover the indictment repeatedly brought against old Israel. And the indictment was that the people would not obey God's commands. And the question here today, Pilate, are we guilty of the same thing today? Is this the reason why much of our prayer efforts fail to accomplish not only things in our life, but in the life of others?
Yeah.
Because we're the disobedient children.
Man.
What is the nature of prayer? Prayer is consenting to what God does say. Don't you know that the call to repentance, anybody know about repentance?
Yes. Yes.
It's essentially a call to agree with whatever God says concerning all the issues, concerning all the values we face in life. I come to tell you, God is the first and the last word that you ought to be listening to.
Yes.
To repent means to change our mind. To repent means we need to get a new attitude. To repent means we need to change our attitude about sin, when we change our attitude about your brothers and sisters, I heard that a radical transformation in our conduct takes place. I heard that a transformation takes place in our actions.
Yeah.
Is the final result. The question is today, are we still like stubborn and disobedient children who refuse the wise counsel of the Almighty God? That God, who is eager to share with us his good and perfect will. What is the nature of prayer? Prayer is asking God for power to obey his will. The Bible says that the fields are white unto harvest. But Matthew 9 says, ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore to send our workers into his harvest field.
Yeah.
Now I come to tell you, the Bible says that, but don't you know that God is more than willing to send our workers to his harvest field? So really, in reality, we don't have to pray to the Lord to send forth workers. Instead, our prayer should be this for the Lord. Lord, what part of the harvest field do you want me to work in?
Yeah.
Lord, what part of the harvest field do you want me to protect?